put them through the annals of internal medicine. This is a e-release pre-publication looking at primary care-based models for the treatment of opioid use disorder. And what they found was that medication-assisted treatment decreases illicit opioid use and prevents relapse and mortality. And this was all treatments based in primary care facilities. And the author's conclusion was that it integrating medication-assisted therapy in primary care settings expands access and enables more physicians to prescribe medication to help people getting off opioids. So I thought that was an interesting thing that is currently about to be released in the Annals of Internal Medicine. So the title of my talk is the opioid epidemic, and it's a national problem with local implications. I'm Dr. Bales here at the Cleveland Clinic in Cleveland, Ohio. So I'd like to accomplish a couple of things today. One is to understand the scope and consequence of the opioid epidemic, understand the evolution and how we got here, and also to learn what is available to either treat addiction or to actually initiate addiction treatment in the clinics. So who am I? I'm trained in family medicine, board certified family medicine doc. I'm also board certified in addiction medicine, and I'm a medical review officer, which speaks to interpreting toxicology and urine drug testing. I'm here at the Cleveland Clinic Family Health Center in Twinsburg, Ohio. And any questions, concerns, you can feel free to email me at dalesr@ccf.org. I'm happy to field questions anytime. The way I usually like to do these is if anybody has questions, feel free to interrupt. You don't necessarily have to follow my slide deck per se. So if there's issues that arise, I'm happy to sort of divert off on tangents. So let's talk about the problem for a little bit. We all know opiate abuse and addiction is increasing. This is true across the country, in every state. And opioid deaths are increasing as well. And this is actually from the CBS News reported on February 7th of this year that in Cuyahoga County, Ohio, so that's the county Cleveland lives in, there were 7 deaths so far this year. We had 18 deaths in the last 8 days. So from Friday to Monday, over this past weekend, we had 18 deaths directly related to opioid overdose. So it's getting worse, and we're seeing particularly virulent heroin out here at the moment. So let's look at something from Las Vegas. So last October, Luminara ordered from the LA Lakers overdosed at a local brothel in Nevada. And now he's a year later in a treatment facility and still maintaining his sobriety. This appeared on the show The Doctors recently. So we're not limited to any one part of the country that's not affected by this problem. The Plain Dealer reported out last year, but this is dated to 2014, that we've seen a 17% increase in injury-related death because of opiates, and since 2007, opiates claim more lives in Ohio than motor vehicle accidents. And this trend plays out nationally as well. So we're actually, you know, some of that may also improve highway safety, but it's the bulk of it is driven by increasing death due to opiates and heroin in particular. So if we look at data from NIH, and this is collected through the auspices of CDC, you can see the bars represent the total number of fatalities from heroin. Men have passed for women, but both are rising steadily, almost on an exponential curve. If we get data beyond 2014, you'll see a rise continue. And these are national death rates. All told, this works out to 91 Americans die every day from opiate overdose. And that's opiate overdose from prescriptions, from methadone, from heroin, so from all sources of opiates. We're seeing a 91, you know, deaths per day across the nation. And then,
so, I'm sorry, did you say that methadone causes death as well? Because isn't that what they use to get people off of heroin?
Methadone used under the guidance of a methadone clinic is used and has been used since the 1960s for treating heroin addiction. Methadone used as a painkiller prescribed out of office can actually be a very dangerous drug, and there have been reported deaths from methadone. Mainly when it's prescribed for pain, and not paying attention to the fact that methadone has a variable hepatic metabolism, and then as you increase the methadone dose, you actually increase its potency. I don't know if you see a lot of methadone, but it is a contributor. There's also cardiac issues with methadone.
Plus, we get it on the street.
I'm sorry?
I said you can get it on the street.
You can
get it. Yes. All of these are definitely available on the street. This is a federal report, so this is criminal justice data, where they tested seized drugs, and the increase in the number of what is thought to be heroin laced with fentanyl has been increasing. And you can see in Ohio, Pennsylvania, Kentucky, that we've had more than 100 seizures just in July to December 2014 of heroin that contained fentanyl. It's clearly a nationwide problem. No one is immune to this. But particularly in the Northeast United States, we're seeing a lot of fentanyl. The last 10 or 12 patients I've treated who presented with heroin addiction have all had cocaine and fentanyl and almost no heroin in Europe. So the problem with this is fentanyl is about 100 times more potent than morphine. So the incidence of death is increasing from this as well. And that's not to mention that there's a batch of heroin going around that has carfentanil in it, which is a veterinary drug. So this slide comes from the American Academy of Addiction Medicine policy statement. And I've highlighted a couple of things in how the American Academy of Addiction Medicine thinks about and characterizes opiate addiction in general. So it's a chronic disease of brain reward. There's diminished recognition of significant problems in one's behavior, and it's progressive and can result in disability or premature death. And by the way, this is their brief definition. The long definition is several pages, but essentially what I want to highlight with this is that we see changes in people's brains in response to substances that affects one's ability to make good judgments, affects one's ability to establish good interpersonal relationships, and it does lead to significant amounts of disability and death. And that doesn't even take into account the legal issues involved with illicit drug use. So I would like to talk to you a little bit about what happens inside the brain, particularly with opiate binding. So on the nerve cell, the mu receptor is your opiate receptor that is most commonly related to addiction. And those receptors, when an opiate is bound to those receptors, we see a dopamine surge in response. So if we look in, for example, the ventral tegmental area, which is one of the reward centers of the brain, you see those centers activated, and then the dopamine projections go to the prefrontal cortex. And this produces the euphoria, the high, the what everybody, what people call the chasing the first high. As we use more and more opiates, we produce more opiate receptors per square micron neuron. Therefore, we have more receptors to fill to get the same effect. And this is where people are constantly saying, I don't get the same feeling that I did when I originally started using. So therefore, they use more drug to get the same feeling. But then they make more receptors, so they're constantly seeing this dose escalation get the same response. And I have that here, as you can see that as we activate the new receptor on the neuron, we get a dopamine release that then is going to essentially project this forward into the prefrontal cortex areas. As we upregulate these new receptors, though, it takes more substance or a more potent substance to get the same response. So there's really four terms that I think everybody needs to know the difference is what they mean. So tolerance is just the inability to get the same response from the same amount of drug given. So anybody who's given an opiate will become tolerant to the drug to some extent. So this is true if you're using it, you know, an oxycodone product for pain control and there's no addiction or abuse problem, they will develop some level of tolerance. Withdrawal is the syndrome that happens when the receptor does not have the opiate on. So if you don't have an opiate and you're tolerant to them, you experience a withdrawal symptom from not having it. So it's having these open receptors. Addiction is a maladaptation of this process. So this is where people use substances, particularly heroin and opiates, for non-medical purposes, use more than prescribed, or use these despite ongoing harms. Dependence plays more into tolerance. So if you have a patient who is treated for chronic pain, they may be dependent on it to relieve their pain and will go through withdrawal if you abruptly stop it, but they don't display the behaviors of addiction. And this is where the problem has evolved from, is that in treating pain, we see people who can use opiate medication safely and effectively and get improved quality to their lives. And then we see other people who they can't. They need more and more and more. They buy from street sources and they go down the addiction path. And it's really hard to, well, it's almost impossible to know is going to go down which avenue without actually giving them an opiate. So some of the rest of the evolution of this is in the 1990s and early 2000s, the medical community was encouraged to treat non-cancer pain the way we treated chronic cancer pain. With the push was on to have pain be the fifth vital sign, no one should leave our offices in pain, and that these long-acting opiates were safe. Turns out not so accurate, but that was the practice milieu in the early 1990s and 2000s when we started to see accelerated numbers of prescriptions for chronic opiates. We also have, just in the last 10 years or so, really applied the chronic disease model of care. So the model of care we use, for example, to treat diabetes or hypertension, to that of addiction. And this has really reframed how we treat addiction, because we look at it as a chronic lifelong disease. that can be managed through multiple modalities. Comorbid medical conditions, particularly mental health concerns. I see at least 50% of the patients I take care of have an underlying mental health condition. This may be depression, anxiety, PTSD, but once you find somebody and get them off of these drugs, then we often find these mental health concerns. And if you don't address the mental health concerns, then the addiction will recur, because part of that is the drugs make you feel numb or flat, which is better than having an out of control anxiety, depression, PTSD. And there's also the question in our society is whether, you know, is this something we treat under a medical disease model, or do we treat as a criminal justice problem with incarceration? That has sort of gone back and forth as to whether somebody who's using should be treated as a medical condition, or should they be incarcerated because it's illegal. Now, if somebody's actually dealing or selling or trading, that's clearly criminal justice. But moving patients who are using more into a medical model for treatment is actually the current, is where we're going with this. Other medical concerns that I worry about. So when I see someone who's actively using heroin, heroin is what I see a lot of. You know, we worry about hepatitis C and HIV from just purely from the IV drug use. We see lots of neglect in dental care. General lack of self-care. So I often see patients who have, in their 30s, never had their cholesterol checked, and haven't addressed their blood pressure, just a host of general primary care issues that haven't been taken care of. Tobacco use is about 70 to 80% in this population. About 8 years ago, I was running a methadone clinic in Illinois, as part of my work with the University of Illinois, and I did a survey, 82% of patients on my methadone clinic smoke cigarettes. So tobacco use becomes another big issue, particularly because it's a very preventable cause of mortality and morbidity in the United States. We often see other drugs and alcohol involved, so people using multiple substances. And then I see a fair amount of unintended pregnancies. So patients often present because they had a positive pregnancy test, and now they want to become, you know, opiate free because of the baby and the pregnancy. So we do see this as well. Any questions? This stands for screening, brief intervention, and referral to treatment. So this is the what can I do when I have a patient who's addicted to opiates. And the first is to start to screen, is to start to look for patients who either may be misusing their prescriptions or using street drugs. Some of this involves using prescription monitoring programs. So in Ohio, ours is called ORS. It's the Ohio RX reporting system. And this is where pharmacists report all controlled substances to a state database. And then we can look into that database to see, you know, have there been multiple prescribers? Are there early prescriptions? So some clues can be derived out of that. We can also screen for drugs and alcohol by things like the CAGE questionnaires. And this is one of those that if we don't ask, most people won't tell us. So actually doing screens in the clinic, looking for these things. Brief intervention stems off of motivational interviewing. So a brief intervention might be, well, how would you like to proceed from this? How get, you know, can I help you get into a treatment program? How would you like to stop using? Would you like to stop using? And this can be done in the primary care setting. And then referral for treatment requires, this is a point we all struggle with, is we need to know the local resources to get people into treatment. So that's local addiction treatment centers. Cleveland Clinic has an addiction treatment center. There are a variety of places, but this is where knowing the local resources and how to tap into them is critically important. Particularly because when somebody comes and says, I have a problem with heroin or Oxycontin or Percocet or whatever opiate they're using and abusing, they want help right then and right now. The time to act with this is now, and being able to move them into a treatment program in a short period of time is what really helps these people. So if you have somebody who's using and say, well, I can get you to a treatment facility in a month, well, they're going to use for another month, and a month down the road, they may not be so motivated to stop using, change their behavior. So the referral for treatment in a very timely fashion is what is critically important to help people who have an addiction problem. And that's actually true for any addiction. That works for smoking, that works for alcohol, is to act as soon as somebody's reaching out for help. So when we talk about treatment, and we're looking at this as a chronic disease model, so treatment is not only prescribe somebody methadone or prescribe somebody Suboxone or, you know, any of the buprenorphine products, or in the case of alcohol, you know, and abuse, things like that. So I've sort of laid out over here on the right side of the screen. The most intensive is inpatient, or a detoxification program in a hospital. These days, this is pretty much limited to alcohol and benzodiazepines. So people who are abusing those two are at risk of seizure from abrupt withdrawal. Otherwise, the insurance companies are not reimbursing very well for inpatient, with some exceptions. There are private treatment inpatient facilities that will gladly take your credit card. So there are, you can pay for these out of pocket. Partial hospitalization is a program where patients come to a treatment facility for 5 to 8 hours a day, 5 days a week, but go home at night. This may go on for 2 to 3 weeks where they come every day for the full day, go home at night. Then we can transition to what's called intensive outpatient. And often this is the entry point for heroin addiction these days, is we start with an intensive outpatient program. This is 3 to 5 days a week, 2 to 3 hours a day of counseling and psychology and meeting with an addiction treatment physician, going to 12-step meetings. So this would be a few hours a day, a couple days a week. And this may go on for 6 weeks. The next level down is outpatient therapy, where you would be seen once a week for an hour, transitioning to once a month. So as we're going down through this list, we're getting less contact hours with the treatment team. But as length away from the drug increases, patients do better. 12-step meetings is the Alcoholics Anonymous model. So there is Narcotics Anonymous, there's Heroin Anonymous, Cocaine Anonymous. But these are all what we call 12-step facilitation meetings that are based on the 12 steps and traditions of Alcoholics Anonymous. These can be found in every community nationwide. Unfortunate here in Ohio that Alcoholics Anonymous was originated in Akron, Ohio, which is only about 20 miles from where I'm sitting. So I have lots of these resources. The other thing to know is local and community resources. particularly ones that will work with Medicaid insurers, will work with private insurance, and will work with people who have no insurance. These often are charity hospitals, standalone addiction treatment centers, but knowing where to get each of these services in your community is what allows you to get a patient who's in your office or on the phone the resources they need in the time they're asking for the help. So if we look, this is a quote from this article from Thomas and others from Psychiatric Services in 2014. If you looked at medication-assisted treatment, so that means either using buprenorphine in an office setting or methadone in a methadone clinic setting, and they found high effectiveness of buprenorphine maintenance in improving retention. So retention in treatment is important for maintaining long-term sobriety and also decreasing illicit opiate use. So when I start somebody on a buprenorphine program, we start off with the expectation that this is going to be a year and a half to 2 year program. So we want to retain these people in treatment as long as we can. And both buprenorphine maintenance and methadone maintenance improve pregnancy-related outcomes by reducing illicit drug use in pregnancy. For years, methadone was the approved or the preferred drug. Now we're seeing poor results for buprenorphine, and we can do buprenorphine therapy in primary care offices where we cannot do methadone maintenance in primary care. And we're seeing improved pregnancy outcomes and improved less drug use, less illicit opiate use, and decreased criminal activity if we use medication to assist in the treatment. So medication alone is not the treatment, it's part of a comprehensive treatment program.
Does that just trade one addiction for another?
No, it's not. Let's talk that through for a minute, because that comes up a lot. Let me back up one. So there's two medications we can use to address opiate addiction, methadone and buprenorphine. Both will bind to the mu receptor in the brain, and they both bind more strongly than any other opiate out there. So what we've done is we've tied up these receptors with something that's going to sit there for long term. So buprenorphine's got a 36-hour half-life and a very high binding affinity. But buprenorphine has no downstream activity. It doesn't activate the receptor. So you don't see the dopamine surge. And what you're doing is you're tying up these receptors to prevent the withdrawal syndrome. So if I can keep somebody from going into withdrawal, then we can do 12-step work, we can do cognitive behavioral therapy, we can address underlying mental health problems. It buys us the time to really engage in therapy. Methadone is an opiate, and there is some activation of the receptor with methadone. So buprenorphine is we call it partial agonist. Methadone is a full agonist. But by keeping people out of withdrawal, we then can engage in meaningful treatment. There are strict controls on how we do this. So example, for a methadone program, you have to come to the methadone program and you swallow the methadone in front of the clinic nurse. It's a directly observed therapy program. With buprenorphine, you have to be seen once a month for your prescription. That way, I don't wait 6 months worth of buprenorphine products and not see somebody for 6 months. I'm seeing these people every 30 days or sooner. Once we decide that we're done with the medication-assisted phase of the treatment, then we can do a controlled taper to taper off, and then therefore to prevent people from going into a withdrawal and relapse. There's actually been programs in the United Kingdom where they've done this with heroin. They actually give IV, pharmaceutical grade IV heroin to do maintenance treatment. There's been some experiments with that. So this is taking advantage of the receptor characteristics in the brain and control the withdrawal syndrome in order therefore to engage in other treatment modalities. So that's why medication-assisted treatment and not medication treatment.
Well, then they still have to be tapered off, so there's still kind of it is a trade from one drug to the next.
It is a trade.
It's a trade to a drug that seems more.
Well, there's a reason.
Less harmful.
There's a reason for it, though.
Yeah. Okay. Well, when it develops. When it develops, when the new receptors are created, do they ever go away? Do they ever?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, so you can downregulate your receptors as well as upregulate them. So as we withdraw the buprenorphine, I might taper somebody over 3 months, 4 months. You slowly start to go back to your baseline level of receptors. And that's actually a problem in our prison systems. So if you take a person and you incarcerate them for dealing heroin, say they're in prison for 6 months to a year, at that time they've gotten almost no heroin again. When they come out, if they use the same amount they used before they went into prison, they overdose and die because they downregulated their receptors so much that their typical usual dose is now a lethal dose. And that's a big concern for the criminal justice system at the moment. Now you do need, let me talk about licensing and how we do these. In order to do methadone maintenance, you must be a licensed, federally licensed methadone clinic. Nobody else can dispense methadone for addiction treatment except these federally qualified clinics. So you can't go writing methadone prescriptions for the addiction out of your family medicine office. That's actually illegal. Buprenorphine has been approved under if you meet certain conditions to do it in an office setting. So I had to take a training class the first year. I could only prescribe 30 prescriptions per month. So essentially, I could have a panel of patients of up to 30 for the first year I did this. Then I could apply to go up to 100. So I'm currently at 100. That's the maximum number of buprenorphine prescriptions I can write in a month. Health and Human Services recently issued a new rule where there are certain individuals that can go up to 275. Patients, but there is these hard caps on how much buprenorphine you can prescribe. And you need to have these licenses and waivers in place in order to do it.
Do you feel like
so a couple of things,
I was gonna just ask,
yes?
Do you feel like 100 people is probably a good maximum for people to try and monitor on a monthly basis and really be able to follow? I mean, that seems like a lot of people to see. So I'm confused by the 275, because I feel like is that prescribing and then leaving them out there to float the boat on their own? I'm confused by the 275. That seems like a lot of people.
So there's a couple of ways to think about this. If you are managing 100 patients, that's not a full-time practice.
Okay.
So So if you're doing that within the context of a family medicine office, 100 is a reasonable amount. And most people who have the licenses don't go up that high. If, on the other hand, you want to have a full-time addiction practice, it's hard to maintain a full-time addiction practice seeing 100 patients a month. I mean, I typically see 80 patients a week, not just for, I'm a family doc, so I see all comers. But so if you're in a busy family practice and you want to do addiction treatment, 100 is plenty. If you're interested in being full-time addiction treatment and want to maximize your efforts to address opioid addiction, that's all you're going to do, then that's where the 275 plays in. In order to go to 275, you have to be board certified in addiction medicine or addiction psychiatry. So that's a very limited number of people out there. Most primary care doctors who are doing addiction treatment are seeing 20 to 30 patients. So the 275 is going to be the exception. That's not going to be very common. The real issue behind that and what Health and Human Services was trying to achieve is that there are people seeking treatment who can't get into a program because we're limited to 100. So I currently turn people away every day because I'm right up against my 100 cap. So they're trying to expand access to services by doing this, but the people who can actually go to 275 are a very restricted number of physicians.
Thank you for clarifying. Thank you.
There you go. You're welcome. I think there's a couple of resources everybody ought to look at. One is the CBRT, that's the Screening, Brief Intervention, and Referral to Treatment. There is a training program, and it's through the SAMHSA website, which is through Health and Human Services. And it's a $50 training course. I think it took me 2 hours to do. And there's tools on there. There are screening tools, and recommendations on how to initiate conversations about addiction. This is available to anybody to take. So there is some actual online training to initiate this. I know here in Cleveland, our residency programs have the residents do this as part of the residency training. So this is actually the buprenorphine training. So in order to prescribe buprenorphine for addiction, so that's the Suboxone, the Zumsol, the Bonobalt. The website, or the link listed right here in the middle is how you get to that training. That's an 8-hour training course, and that will then allow you to apply for the waiver to be licensed to prescribe. Another thing we tell a lot of people about this is the manufacturer of Suboxone website is Suboxone.com, and they keep a registry of physicians who are licensed to prescribe Suboxone. This is something patients could go to. So you can point your patients in this direction and say, well, if you're interested in a Suboxone treatment program or a Suboxone-based treatment program, here's a resource where you can put your zip code and address in, and they will actually show you the physicians who are licensed in your area. The other thing that Health and Human Services just released in January, and I didn't get it on this slide, is that now nurse practitioners can apply for the waiver as long as they're working with a collaborative physician who is licensed to do buprenorphine therapy. So now physician assistants and nurse practitioners can get this training and treat up to 30 patients. And I think that's all the slides I have. How about questions, concerns?
Yes, I have a question for you, doctor.
It has multiple layers, so I was wondering if you could speak on the latest research of cannabinoid and opioid interaction in chronic pain, as well as specifically how do opiates interact with the CB1 and CB2 receptors, and do cannabinoids interact with the MU receptors?
So I'm not, the current cannabinoid pain research is a little outside of my area of expertise. I know they have been working on looking at can cannabinoids increase the effectiveness of other pain modalities, but to speak directly to that research, I'm not familiar with that. I don't see a lot of interaction between the two, but the concept is that my understanding is that using a cannabinoid can enhance your other modalities and therefore potentially decrease the amount of opiates needed to treat pain. That's about all I know about that field of research.
Thank you.
Really, Mike? Yeah, you're welcome. I really am mostly seeing heroin addiction.
I got a question for you. How come it takes so long for the brain to stop sending an electrical spike after they've stopped taking opiates? Like people that have to take a quarter pill every 4 weeks, otherwise they get an electrical spasm in the brain. What is that?
So there's a couple of issues with that. There's usually as you taper the dose down, if you do a 20% dose reduction, either per week or per 2 weeks, that's a pretty good pace. There have been reports, particularly with benzodiazepines and longer-acting opiates, of what's called a post-acute withdrawal syndrome that can last 2 years. So you may still see effects 2 years out in these post-acute or sub-acute withdrawal syndromes. If you do a 20% dose reduction, most people within 6 to 8 weeks will pretty much be through the withdrawal period, but there is this protracted withdrawal that can last up to 2 years. And it's been particularly noted with benzodiazepines.
So then even theoretically, what would need to be in place to stop that electrical spike from happening, even if you speak to it theoretically?
I didn't hear that question.
All right, you're talking about binding up the extra receptors that were created during the addiction, correct?
Right.
And you use that as your primary way of treating the addiction, is to bind those up so that the body doesn't crave it, and then you can step them down from whatever their opiate they're addicted to. So if someone was to be clear of it in a 10-day period, is that then because those receptors were already all bound up and then they just diminished back to the point before the addiction?
Yes, so as you reduce the dose, as you step the dose down,
yep,
you start to make less and less receptors per micron of nerve cell. We all have a baseline number of receptors that bind,
Yeah, I would. Yeah, is it possible?
Internal opiates. Yeah.
Well, is it possible to just necrotize them and have them go away and be reset back to a previous state before the addiction? Even if it's theoretical, I just was wondering.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes, it's theoretically, you are able to get back to baseline with your number of opiate receptors, so you can downregulate back to baseline.
Yeah.
It does take several weeks of being completely opiate free. So that's where the tapers come into play. As we start to taper, I've actually had people who take 1 milligram of buprenorphine every other day or every third day until they actually come off. And we're taking advantage of this resetting of the receptors.
Okay, all right, thank you.
So, Doctor,
yes,
you spoke about the interaction of benzos and opiates in treatment programs, if someone is using both of those and you're weaning them off, what is the implications of that?
Well, there's a couple of issues with benzodiazepines. One is abrupt cessation of benzodiazepine can precipitate a seizure. So the long-term use of benzodiazepines actually lowers your seizure threshold. So there are concerns that you don't want to abruptly stop someone off of these without bringing them to the hospital. They often use a phenobarbital taper in the hospital. The other concept is to change them from something short-acting to something longer-acting, and then cut back on the longer-acting benzodiazepine. So where, you know, somebody may be abusing alprazolam, you switch them to something like clonazepam or diazepam or Librium, chlorhexidine oxide, and then taper down with the longer-acting benzodiazepine, because what you're really worried about is somebody having a grand mal seizure. Same is true for alcohol. So when I see somebody who's alcoholic, especially if they're drinking, you know, 1 to 2 liters of hard liquor a day, abruptly stopping that could precipitate an alcohol withdrawal seizure. So that either needs to be handled inpatient in a treatment facility, or we use these long-acting benzodiazepines for seizure prophylaxis as we're getting somebody off of alcohol. And I've had people present to me after I quit drinking, you know, 24 to 48 hours ago, and I had a seizure because I decided, hey, I was done drinking. So those are the two that really are being approved for inpatient treatment because of this danger.
Thank you.
Doctor, have you worked with anything outside the box? Any other type of treatments for opiate addiction besides drugs?
Well, there are abstinence-only programs out there that use cognitive behavioral therapy, 12-step. Some people are using a technique based off of dialectic behavioral therapy where they don't use medication to assist in the treatment. But it's usually one or the other. And there's only really two medications for medication assistance anyways. But there are programs out there that are abstinence only, and they work.
They're working, and I don't think they work.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear the question.
Anything at all, have you ever heard of a treatment that they're doing intravenous nutrition, such as glutathione, Myers cocktail, or B supplements, omegas, and they put it in IV and put it in their system? Now there's one protocol they did that with finasenol as well, and they gave people detoxed in 3 days without any other drugs, just the intravenous nutrition and the finasenol.
I have seen different protocols for that. There's also the medical-induced comas they tried. Currently, none of those are approved or licensed.
Right.
And there's also a medication called Ibogaine, which you may see offshore Ibogaine clinics. Again, not approved or licensed in the United States, but some of these rapid detoxes are based on that. I have seen some of that. I've never actually participated.
I had one doctor who said that did the protocol for that, for the intravenous nutrition and then the finasenol. There's a gentleman that had it that was bringing it out to the public, or do clinicals in prisons actually. And the guy that, unfortunately, the gentleman that started the company took it public and ran away with $140 million.
Huh?
It was Michael Milken's best assistant, but I'm just trying to, it was interesting because it seemed to work. They paid $50,000 to go to learn the protocol. Just like when Suboxone came out, there's only select doctors that did it and they had to pay to learn the protocol. But this is the same, same method. I just wonder if you've heard of it, that's all.
You know, I haven't heard of that protocol specifically, but I have, like I said, there are other ones out there. As far as I know, none of them are officially approved or licensed by the FDA.
Right. I got that. Are you familiar with the FDA, this licensed deal for an app? It's pretty interesting. Actually, I got it on my phone because I get their emails daily. And they were giving somebody $30,000 if they could produce an app that the addict, when he starts to overdose, he can hit his app and they'll tell him where naloxone, the closest naloxone is to him. And I thought maybe the FDA has never seen a drug before.
Interesting.
Yeah, I have it. I can email it to you, actually. The alert.
Yeah,
pretty interesting.
Jasmine has my slide set. My email's on second or third slide.
Okay, great. Thank you, Doc.
I mean, it's essentially bailsr@ccf.org. I'd be happy with that.
Okay. Appreciate your time.
Thank you so much, Dr. Bales, for your presentation today. If you could just give him a round of applause.